You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello and welcome back to Physics 195, Introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I am Bruce Betts, your tour guide to the solar system and beyond. A couple quick things for those enrolled in the class. There are, as of a few days ago, assignments and things to do and more descriptions up on the Blackboard system. For those not enrolled in the class or watching this after the fact, there's information at planetary.org/betsclass. And one quick clarification for those not officially enrolled in the class who want to get a certificate at the end of the course, and I do give a certificate random space fact each class, we will not put that quiz up until the end of the class after all the classes have transpired. More information at planetary.org/betsclass. As you can see from the phone numbers, the emails and such popping up on the bottom of the screen, if you are watching this live, you can submit questions that I will try to address as we go along. Today we talk about telescopes, all sorts of kinds of telescopes, from small amateur ones to giant optical ones to radio to space telescopes. And then we're going to talk about the moon, not only as the moon, but as a marker, a savor of history of the solar system. And we'll also talk about moon-related things that affect Earth or that you can see from Earth, like eclipses, like tides, like phases, and the like. So start with telescopes, head to the moon, and lots of pictures and videos along the way. Let's get started. There are two basic kinds of telescopes, those with lenses, which were like the first ones developed about 400 years ago, and those with mirrors, and then there are mixtures of the two. So here is an example. Let's go ahead and go full screen on that. An example of an amateur telescope, fairly entry level but good telescope that uses lenses. This is called a refractor because it refracts the light down the tube to a point back here. Now this has some type of reflector right here that will shoot the light up to your eye, but fundamentally the process involves a lens here at the front edge. I gotta get my red back. There we go. Liking the red. Okay, on to the next one, full screen. And this is a amateur reflector. And so the light comes in, goes through either an open area or in a combination version, some type of lens. But fundamentally, most of where the light collection and magnification occurs is at the back end instead of the front end, and it uses mirrors. So light comes down, bounces back up to wherever you're looking at it. In this case, sorry, we'll look at some better diagrams that don't rely on my drawing. Light would come up here and then in this case be reflected out to an eyepiece and your eye in that case. And we'll look at some more detailed diagrams of those, but fundamentally these are these and combinations. So now there are ones that have corrective lenses that take care of certain badness with light aberrations or enable a smaller telescope that mix the reflector and the refractor. But the two basic kinds, reflector with mirrors, refractor with lenses. When they first started to be used, it was all lenses, again, early 1600s. Galileo, the first one to take these new inventions and formally study the sky with them and use them. And what can you see? So last time we talked about what you can see with just your eye or your eye supplemented by binoculars. Don't forget binoculars. They're a good astronomical tool for a lot of just fun stuff to look at in the sky. But if you want to take the next step up, you go to telescopes. You can get a whole variety of different sizes, different qualities, etc. Well, what can you see with them? Let's take a look at the next image, which are drawings that give a good idea of what you can see with the different planets with a pretty good amateur telescope. So not entry level, mid level, but still I'll point out what you can see even with less than that. So let's look at this full screen. So Mercury, when you can, you know, I keep changing the color. Well, we'll just go with that delightful color. Mercury, you can actually see phases, and we'll talk about phases of the moon a little bit later on. But notice for Mercury and for Venus, the two planets inwards towards the sun from the Earth, you see variation in phases. And that's because we can see a good portion of the unlit side, like in this, we're seeing mostly the night side of Venus with a little bit of the bright side, the lit side. And that varies depending on where Venus and Earth are in their orbits. Whereas once you go to the planets like Mars farther out or Jupiter, we see very little or none of the night side, and so we're pretty much always seeing full disk. So with Mercury and Venus, you're looking mostly to pick out phases probably in terms of what you see with a small telescope. And with Mars, you can get various amounts of detail, but Mars varies considerably how large it is in the sky because of the similarity in the Earth and Mars orbits, because of the elliptical nature of Mars's orbit. We get a lot of variability, but there are things, we'll take a look in two or three slides at some of the more detailed things that big telescopes see with Mars. You can see some of those. So you may see light and dark patches. You may be able to see polar caps. You also may not, but you'll at least get a reddish color nicely out of it. Jupiter is a great object for a small telescope because not only can you see Jupiter, you won't see this many cloud bands unless you've got a really nice telescope, but you may see a few bands, you know, two or three, and if you're looking at the right time, you may be able to pick out the great red spot, and you almost certainly will be able to see the four Galilean satellites, the large moons of Jupiter, as they move. Over time, they change positions, and I'll talk about that in a moment. Saturn, the cool thing, a billion miles away, you can see rings. And so the rings of Saturn, truly the impressive thing, impressive. You also may be able to see moons, particularly Titan. Uranus, Neptune, Pluto. Uranus and Neptune, you may be able to get disks. You may get some of the bluish color. Pluto, you pretty much can get a dot. So that's kind of what you can see with amateur telescopes. Let me take a question appropriately from Hale, as in the Hale telescope at Palomar. Why do telescopes have larger objective lenses? I assume you're asking objective compared to, which is the one out at the front end of the telescope compared to the other lenses in the telescope, because that's what you're doing is you're gathering the most amount of light and then focusing it down. So that initial large objective lens does the focusing while enabling you to collect the largest amount of light. All right, I mentioned I was gonna talk a little more about the Galilean satellites and observing them yourself. These you can actually see with binoculars if you hold them still enough. They will appear as points of light. This is Jupiter's moons Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto. And you can actually watch them move from night to night. So Io has a period of about 1.5 days to go around Jupiter, a little bit more. Europa's 3.5 days, Ganymede's 7 days, Callisto's 17. So what that means is when you look night to night, you can actually see these points of light moving in the sky. And in fact, that's what Galileo saw that got him in so much trouble, what the implications he drew from that, seeing with his telescope, because he figured out that something was orbiting around Jupiter, therefore not everything orbits around the Earth. Not a popular belief in 1610, but indeed the correct one. So let's look at the next image, full screen. This is taken just, I took this with a digital camera, 250 millimeter lens. Let's go full screen. So we don't see a fabulous image like you would like a telescope, but my point is, this is kind of what you would get with binoculars, is Jupiter. it's obviously washed out in my image. You may be able to see a cloud band or two, but what you can watch are these points of light. Those are the four large moons of Jupiter, and they'll move side to side. You can find charts online that will tell you which one's which on any given night and predict the changes that are going on with them. Now, let's talk about, we're going to keep talking about optical telescopes for a while, and we're going to keep talking about ground-based telescopes for a while, then we'll get into space-based and other wavelengths. So for optical telescopes, for the first 300 years-ish of optical telescopes, there was one detector, people's eyes, and they would try to draw what they saw. And that was it. And then we developed film and photographic plates, and then later digital detectors, and things all got better and improved. But initially it was with your eye, and a lot of what you might do in amateur astronomy is with your eye. Now, there are some dangers to that, because as brilliant as the eye-brain combination is, there are certain things that you're familiar with of optical illusions. Well, one of the more famous optical illusions in astronomy was an astronomer who did all sorts of great stuff named Percival Lowell, who observed Mars around the turn of the century, the 1900-ish. And let's look at some of the drawings he made of Mars, and then I'll take a question. But first, let's look at this. So this is what a drawing of the surface of Mars done by Percival Lowell, and notice that in addition to dark and light areas, which indeed are there and that one sees with a decent telescope, he started to connect the dots and he thought he saw lines. Turns out this is a bit of a natural optical illusion, and because he saw what he thought, what he drew, thinking he saw, saw straight lines, he inferred the end because he saw polar caps, the icy polar caps in the south and north pole, and that the polar caps grew and shrunk. There were no ice obvious in the middle of the planet, and there were these straight lines. So he can deduce they were canals, and that there were aliens, there were Martians who were taking water from the poles and moving it to the dry equatorial regions, spawning a whole huge boom, which we still haven't gotten over, of science fiction about Mars. But it turns out not so much. There are, interestingly, channels that you can't see from Earth, but you can see from spacecraft, that were cut naturally by lots of water, but not these straight canals. So just a word of the wise. Next image, we can see Mars with pretty good sized telescopes and how it varies over time. Let's look at this full screen. So this is going from 1907 to 1973, but a lot of these variations are actually seasonal. Mars's year is about almost two Earth years, and so you see polar caps grow and shrink, and you see the dark markings change and brighten and darken. Well, the polar cap shrinking and growing we'll talk about when we talk about Mars, but it's the ice cap, the carbon dioxide ice, mostly freezing out of the atmosphere. And then the dark areas tend to get covered by global dust storms periodically, brightening them up and reddening them. So anyway, Mars, neat place to look at telescopes. Let me take a question from Allie. To see all these different things in the night sky, where would be best to get the best view? We will see some of those places, and the answer is a dark sky. And ideally, certainly if you're going to place a professional telescope, you want to be up on a mountain, because you want to get above as much of the atmosphere as possible. So the atmosphere is our enemy when we're trying to do ground-based astronomy. That's why stars twinkle in the night sky. It's not because stars are actually twinkling. It's because the atmosphere is moving and shimmering, kind of like if you look at across a desert road and you see that shimmering from the heat and the convection. Well, all that turbulence in the atmosphere, clouds, water vapor, which is particularly nasty like in the infrared, you want to get above that. So that's why all the big observatories are on mountaintops and why all the ones being built now or in the last few decades are built places away from population centers. They were before too, but a lot of the population centers have grown closer. So in terms of amateur astronomy, you want to go to a dark site, whatever that is, whether that's out in the agricultural fields, the desert, the mountains, somewhere like that. You can do things from urban environments, particularly with planets. Planets are nice and bright, at least out till you get out to Uranus. And so you can do something just from non-dark skies of having fun. All right. So the progression, we just looked at some photos of that were probably done on photographic plates of Mars. We talked about using the eye. Obviously, you can, particularly in amateur astronomy, use the eye. You can hook up cameras now. And the real revolution after film and photographic plates were digital imagers, and now we're totally familiar with that. Two or three decades ago, when I was getting into this field, the only people that, it was just at where telescopes were starting to use digital imagers, digital detectors, things that would saturate the market for cameras. A decade or two later, started in astronomy. You can just put the next image up behind me. This is a image of a CCD detector, a charge-coupled device. There are also CMOS detectors, other acronyms. But the point is that you're doing digital detection rather than using film, and you have all the advantages that you get for regular everyday photography. In astronomy, you also get those advantages of more precise detections. And so astronomers are still using these type of things, but usually ahead of they're on the cutting edge with detectors, sizes of detectors, sensitivity, calibration. But still the same type of thing with cameras. So let's talk more about refractors, big refractors. We talked about little refractors. So let's look at the next image full screen. If we've got that. Yeah, we can go ahead and skip to the next one. So that was just an example of a CCD chip. So this is a Keplerian refracting telescope. It has to do with the layout. It's the simplest layout. I described it before. You've got a lens here. You got a lens here. You look through here or put your camera back here. An image that is an arrow upright like this will end up getting inverted when you send it through this simple system. So you'll see things upside down, which you don't care nearly as much about when you're looking at sky objects. And notice this, notice that you've got the biggest piece, the subjective lens is at the front end of your telescope. It is only supported around the edges by the structure. This, I will come back to why this is significant in astronomy. Next image is a picture of the largest refracting telescope ever used for real science, for astronomy. This is the Yerkes Observatory near Chicago, and it is about 1 meter diameter, 40 inches at the main lens, and then focuses down just like we saw in that last diagram. Now, this is the largest astronomical refracting telescope at about a meter. You may ask yourself, self, why? Why only that big? There are mirrors that are 5 meters and now 10-meter telescopes that with mirrors. Well, it goes back to that lens and placement. And so when you put a big lens on the end of your telescope, first of all, it gets really heavy and hard to move around. Second of all, you're only supporting it around the edges. And that means that as it moves, as temperatures shift, as it shifts, you get small changes in the lens because of that unsupported weight up there at the end. And so even if you can make a big lens, which is awfully hard to do to begin with, a very precise lens, you still end up having it changing over the course of observations and causing messy data. So that's why all the biggest telescopes in the world, all the professional telescopes in the world, for the last several decades, are reflectors. They have mirrors. Let's look at the next image, a diagram of one, a Newtonian reflector. Let's look at that full screen. I'm going to grab some water. So we've got basically just an open tube with where now instead of a lens, we have nothing up here at the end. Light comes in, reflects off a mirror, comes back to what's called a secondary mirror, which in the case of a Newtonian, then sends it out of the telescope to a detector or eyepiece up here. By putting your big optical element at the back of the telescope, you now, well actually, let's look at the next image and then I'll show you an example. Next image is just a different alignment. This is called a Cassegrain alignment. Now, same thing, come in through an open tube, hit a lens, come back to a secondary, but instead of sending it out the side, you send it down out the back, which is far more practical for big telescopes. And you may say, well, but you had to put a hole in the telescope. Doesn't that screw things up? Well, the scale isn't shown too well. Typically, this is done with telescopes that are fairly large. In any case, it doesn't mess you up. It reduces your amount of light that you collect, but it doesn't screw you up that much to put a hole through the center. Next image, let's look at one of the largest optical telescopes in the world. This is one of the two Keck telescopes in Hawaii on top of a 14,000 foot mountain, a 5 kilometer high mountain. And here, this is the primary mirror down here, and it is 10 meters across. Now they've actually made that with a bunch of, you may not be able to see it, but there are 36 hexagons that are all next to each other and form this 10 meter mirror. You have other mirrors that are single pieces of usually glass that are aluminized and used as the primary mirror, in this case Keck. Now let's get back to that reflecting refracting thing. Now you've got the mirror where you can put, other than a hole through the middle, you can put all the support you want on that mirror. And so now, and it's on the bottom of your telescope, so it's easier to move the weights down at the bottom, not up at the top. And you can support the telescope. You can even get fancier like they did with Keck and later telescopes, where they have different segments that they can actually adjust those segments just barely to account for any changes in the telescope that occur over time or adapting to whatever the environment is. So that's why all your big telescopes are reflectors. Let's look at the next image and give you a different setup, which is not usually built into telescopes now, but was in the past. Let's look at that full screen. So this is like a Newtonian or a Cassegrain, but you take the light and you send it straight to a point here, which is called the prime focus. So there are no other mirrors or optical elements. So that's the good news. The bad news is you gotta actually put your detectors at the prime focus, and unless you've got a ginormous telescope, you can't do that. Let's look at the next image full screen, which is me standing in front of a ginormous telescope where they actually did this, the Palomar 200-inch Hale telescope, 5-meter telescope. And they've got, this is all the big horseshoe, well, that's my face. This is the big structure that supports the telescope, and this is the tube of the telescope. Notice you don't need sides to your telescope. And the primary mirror is down here somewhere, and it reflects light and can actually reflect it to the so-called prime focus cage. Particularly early in the use of Palomar, they actually used the prime focus cage and put detectors more frequently up here. Later, they put a secondary here. They still have the prime focus cage, and they direct the light down and through a hole in the base of the telescope so they can get to much larger instruments, spectrometers and the like, that spread the light out and allow us to do spectroscopy like we talked about in the last thing. But it's kind of fun that Palomar actually has a prime focus cage. It was actually used even for eye observations. They actually had an eyepiece, which leads me to debunking one of the common, myth may be the wrong word, yes, but one of the common misconceptions about large telescopes and astronomy. Professional astronomers don't use eyepieces. They haven't for decades. It's fun, but they don't. They're using cameras, they're using detectors, they're using advanced spectrometers. Even if they're looking at an image, they're looking at it from a control room that's nice and warm and happy instead of the freezing cold telescope where you want to keep it cold so it stays thermally balanced. In any case, no eyepieces. Telescopes built after this telescope, professional telescopes can't even accommodate an eyepiece. So the concept of astronomers spending all their nights staring through eyepieces on telescopes, once upon a time, 100 years ago, yes, not so much now. Also, typically, professional astronomers will get data from a couple nights a year, a few nights a year if they're lucky, spend the rest of the year analyzing it. So there's actually very little time spent at the observatory for any given professional astronomer. One of the places they go besides Palomar is the following. Let's look at the picture of Kitt Peak National Observatory in Arizona in the United States. This is just to point out, once you find a nice place to put a telescope, usually other people want to put their telescopes there too. So there's several of these are owned by the US government. Some of them have been privatized. Let's look at that full screen just so you can get a better view of it. So you have everything from 4-meter telescopes to solar telescopes to 2-meter, 1-meter, all stuck on the same mountaintop. Mauna Kea at Hawaii, or several places in Chile now, are becoming like this, just kind of gardens that grow telescopes, so to speak, because they are the best, particularly nowadays, Hawaii and Chile, two of the best observing sites in the world. Chile gives you the southern hemisphere and more southern sky, and is located at or near the Atacama Desert, the driest desert in the world. So you get a very dry sky up above. Mauna Kea, you might think it's very humid, but even there at 14,000 feet, you're above the humidity we associate with Hawaii. All right, one more note about optical ground-based telescopes, then we're going to fly into the sky and talk about space telescopes. Let's look at the next image full screen, please. This is, I mentioned Keck, that we looked at the mirrors for. Keck is actually has two telescopes, two 10-meter telescopes. They can actually sometimes combine the light from these two, although it's very tricky. We'll talk about it for radio telescopes, for which it is easier in just a few minutes, and that's called interferometry. You combine but you have to understand things really, really precisely to do so. All right, let's go into space. Remember why we would want to go into space? We talked about that last time, atmospheric transmission. So even at places like optical wavelengths where the light gets through the atmosphere messes with it. And they've gotten fancier and fancier at being able to deal with that on the ground. In fact, let me mention that. They use a technique called adaptive optics now, where they will shoot a laser out from the telescope and then observe it and what happens to that very tight beam in the atmosphere. And then on the mirrors of the telescope, typically on the secondary mirror, they will actually make adjustments to adjust in real time to the turbulence in the atmosphere. It's really quite amazing, and it doesn't take you to space telescope level where you have no atmosphere, but on the other hand, you can build a much bigger telescope on the ground and maintain it much easier and cheaper. And so adaptive optics has really been revolutionary. We'll take a look at some data and contrast it, particularly when we talk about the outer planets using adaptive optics. But ideally, in a perfect world, with no real limitations like you actually have, like money and getting large things into space, you'd put things in space so you don't have to look through the atmosphere. There are some wavelengths, as we saw from the atmospheric transmission chart last week, where you just can't do astronomy from the ground because of stuff like this. Water in the atmosphere will screw you up for infrared wavelengths, and their gamma ray, X-ray don't make it through the atmosphere. So we build space telescopes, the most famous of which is the Hubble Space Telescope, 25 years old now. Let's go to the next image, full screen. Here's an image of the Hubble Space Telescope in space. But remember, it is a telescope. It works like all the others we've been talking about fundamentally. Light comes in, hits a primary, comes to a secondary, in this case gets reflected back to the instruments here. There, of course, are things that you have in space, like an antenna to communicate with the data to Earth. This is just basically a lens cap that was popped off 25 years ago and opened up. And astronauts have flown some missions to change the instruments and update the detectors over time. Let us look at the next image. So this is just basically, breaking it into its component pieces, which I mostly just mentioned, but I do point out also you need solar panels to power your spacecraft in space, and your instruments go back here, your primary mirrors here. Now, how well can Hubble Space Telescope see? Well, I just happen to have a random space fact video for you. So let's take a look at that. You may recognize, no, you probably won't. Go ahead.
Random spin spurt.
How well can the Hubble Space Telescope see? Well, it's got a resolution of 0.05 arc seconds. What does that mean? Well, if you had Hubble's vision, and you were in beautiful Pasadena, California, near Los Angeles, you could see two fireflies only a meter apart in New York City. Let's give it a try, shall we?
Hey, what are you looking at?
I'm bioluminescent here. Decided to finish that for you. That telescope I was holding, of course, a very high quality astronomical telescope. No, not really. So Hubble, very impressive seeing characteristics, and again, not having all telescopes have those, big telescopes have those type of theoretical numbers, but with Hubble Space Telescope, you're not looking through the atmosphere, so you actually get close to achieving those type of resolutions. That's part of why we get such wonderful, beautiful data from Hubble. Now, as I mentioned, if you want to go into the infrared and do it well, depending on what part of the infrared, some you can see ground-based, but some you can't. You fly a space telescope, and another one of the so-called NASA great observatories that were that were launched by people who could speak more coherently than I can, is Spitzer Space Telescope. Let's look at an image of it while it was still on the ground. Again, with infrared telescopes, you're still going to see something that looks pretty similar to an optical wavelength, visible wavelength telescope. Let's look at that full screen. So, essentially, tube down to mirrors, detectors, like we talked about before. Now, it does come with not only solar panels, but essentially a heat shield. It becomes more important in the infrared. You often want to cool your detectors and keep your detectors cold because you are trying to sense fewer photons, and it makes the detector happy to keep it chilled and cold, and so you want things like heat shields. Things get really weird when you go to some other wavelengths. For example, X-ray. We have flown X-ray space telescopes. First of all, you have to fly a space telescope because you can't see it from the ground. And there's the little issue with X-rays that you may have noticed from medical imaging, that if you point an X-ray at something, and this is true for most mirrors, it will go through the mirror, and that's really not what you want when you want to be focusing something. So what you can do with an X-ray is if you have, this is the mirror, you have the the X-ray come in near what's called grazing incidence, really low angle, then it actually will reflect. So you end up with crazed optical designs like the following. Let's look at the next image full screen. So this is another one of these ray diagrams, but notice you've got a bunch, you have mirrors that now instead of being like this, the mirrors are like this. And what you're doing is taking the X-rays as they come in and kind of gradually bouncing them off a mirror here and a mirror there, and then bringing them down into a focus back here. So you have these nested mirrors that the X-rays are hitting near grazing incidence. Next image is the Chandra X-ray Observatory Space Telescope. And it uses exactly this design. So X-rays come in and they get gradually bent down towards the detectors. So weird stuff. Let's look at let's take a question. From Hale, how does the Hubble Space Telescope turn to view a specific planet, or does it only pick up what runs into its lens? No, it's actually quite steerable. They point it where they want it to, and then they will keep it pointed at that object as long as they need to observe it. And it's, basically using reaction wheels. So you have something spinning in there, and gyroscope, and you change the rotation speed of the gyroscope, and it will end up having an effect on rotating the telescope.
and you do pointing with those in different axes. That's fundamentally how you do it. And actually, it was those going out was what was threatening to limit Hubble, and they added one last repair mission that replaced some of those, giving it a longer lifetime, and it's still working happily. Okay, radio. Radio wavelengths. In our modern world, you're quite familiar with what radio dishes look like. Satellite TV and the like uses radio wavelength dishes. Let's look at the next image full screen. This is an example at Goldstone in the California desert of a large radio antenna. And in some ways, you have the same basic concept. Light comes in this case, radio wavelength light, and this dish, this paraboloid-shaped dish, focuses those radio waves to a point. Now, in the case of radio, you usually just put your detector right here at the secondary, the prime focus, or the secondary, and that's where you detect your radio waves coming in. Now, radio wavelengths in some ways are easier because basically the smoothness you need to get of your mirror surface needs to be about a quarter of the wavelength of ballpark of the light that you're trying to detect. When you're trying to detect light that's measured in microns or hundreds of nanometers, billionth of a meter, like visible light, then you need a very smooth, exactly crafted surface. When you're talking about a meter wavelength for a telescope like this, well, you don't have to machine things quite so precisely. And you also reflect things with radio waves that you don't, using stuff like metal, you don't have to have fancy aluminized surfaces. Now, the downside is most radio astronomy is trying to detect much lower amounts of electromagnetic radiation, and so part of the reason you use very big dishes, many tens of meters, 70-meter dish out in Goldstone, and we will take a look shortly at the largest radio dish, but first, just a quick diagram. Let's go to the next diagram quickly at that, just because I basically already covered that. It's just saying you then run you run the electronics out back down, whatever your signal is, and you go into things like amplifiers and computers and such. Let's look at the next image. And this is the largest radio telescope in the world. It's about 300 meters across, three football fields, 1,000 feet-ish. And this is Arecibo Radio Observatory in Puerto Rico. It's basically built into a valley in the surrounding area. The good news is you have the biggest dish by far in the world. The bad news is you can't move it. It's just too big and heavy. So what you do is you move the secondary. And you can see this is even, I think, a little off-center at this point. So this dish will be taking and focusing things from different parts of the sky to different parts of the area where the secondary would be, so you can effectively point it by changing the location of your secondary. Still, your disadvantage is you can't get down low towards the horizon or even close to it. The good news is what you can see,
you have a lot of collecting area. All right, next, let's run a quick video and leave my audio up. This just mostly amused me when I found it. For those of you who play the open world crafting game Minecraft, as my sons and I do some, someone was crazed enough to create the Arecibo radio dish in Minecraft. Let's take a look at that. So indeed, here we are in the forest surrounding. There's the secondary. It's pretty nicely to scale. So you get an idea. And while that finishes up, I'll take a look at questions that are waiting for me. Okay. So a question from Genesia. Sorry if I mispronounced that. What advantages or disadvantages do telescopes have over regular DSLR cameras when photographing things in space? You get more magnification. We can stop that video whenever you're ready.
So the advantage of the telescope is you have more light gathering area. So you can see a lot more, a lot better. You're magnifying what you're seeing. You can pick up lower light things. So ideally you do things like connect cameras to telescopes. But for brighter objects like Jupiter, Galileo satellites, even some of the bright nebula, comets, you can do something with cameras. Cameras also will tend to have a much wider field of view. So if you're not sure where a meteor is going to fall, in a meteor shower, you may just open the lens and look at a big swath of sky, whereas a telescope's going to see a very tiny part of the sky. So it depends a little on what you're trying to look at. Also, and this seems to come up, and I should address it on, thought I had addressed it on Blackboard, but apparently it's still confusing for people enrolled in the class. Will there be questions of the day for this course? No. If not, how will you get participation points? Please read the syllabus, and hopefully it will be clear. If not, I'll tell you right now, you will be doing discussion board assignments for participation, and right now you have an assignment to do an introduce yourself blog. So there are 4 discussion boards, and the introduce yourself blog will count for that.
All right.
Back to fun and festivities. You can also, we talked about interferometers with Keck and 2 big optical telescopes. Well, this is really goes back a few decades now with using it for radio astronomy. Let's take a look at the next image, full screen. And this is the Very Large Array, the VLA, in New Mexico in the United States. And it consists of lots and lots of these 25 millimeter antennas. They are on railroad tracks. You can move them farther apart and closer together as you trade off what you're trying to do, resolution, field of view, things like that. And what happens is you can, all these point at the same target in the sky. You collect data from that target, and then by using fancy things like the phase of the radio waves, you can combine that data and in some respects get the equivalent of a telescope this big. Now, you don't have nearly that collecting area, and there are other disadvantages, but you can get a big boost that's bigger than what you would expect. It's more than, if you have 2 telescopes, you get more than just twice as much. Certainly if you have this many, you get a lot of benefit for doing radio astronomy. Let's look at the next video that shows the VLA in action. You can leave my sound up. And this is what it looks like when you start pointing all of those things at the same time. Now this is over a 5-minute period, a time lapse where they're changing position and pointing. So go ahead and run that video when you're ready. But it also, although this is a changing of pointing in the sky, you also will track objects as the sky moves. And that's true all the way from an amateur telescope to an optical telescope to a radio telescope to get enough data on whatever object you are, you will keep moving your telescope to match the movement of the sky, which is really the movement of the Earth rotating, and continue to look at things. So I just thought that was kind of cool. One last point on data from imagery data, in case you hadn't thought about this before. Let's look at the next image, full screen. Quick note that each pixel element in an image, say of Saturn, will have a certain value, a value of brightness at that particular wavelength that may range from 0 black to whatever, depending on how many bits you're using, may go to 255 or much larger numbers. And that's just a quick pass to indicate that a lot of science is really pulling out quantitative data. We're gonna look mostly at qualitative. Pretty pictures, this is brighter than that, this is darker. But there's a lot of science done by extracting and comparing pixel by pixel, the detailed flux, the brightnesses, and learning really what's going on, digging into that data. Speaking of digging into data, let's dig into the moon. All right, I don't know if that was the right segue, but we're moving on to the moon in any case. Let's take a look at the next image, which I think we looked at in our first lecture, but it's quite lovely. It's from the Galileo spacecraft doing a flyby of Earth on its way out to Jupiter. Let's look at that full screen. So this is the Earth-Moon system. We do live in a system with the Earth and the Moon, and we'll talk about some of the implications of that. In this case, it's kind of the Moon in the foreground of the Earth. It can make it look like the Moon's a lot closer to the Earth than it really is. Let's look at the next image. hope this works. In case it's not on your screen, but hopefully you can see, this is the Earth-Moon system to scale. Here's the Earth, and on the same scale of size and distance, there is the Moon. And so they are, compared to the size of the bodies, this far apart. So this is why it's hard to show it, and depending on your screen, you may or may not be seeing it, but note, it does bring up what will be one of the common themes in this class that I like to point out. Space is mostly empty. And this is even one of the busier parts with two bodies, but space is mostly really empty, unless you like to look at ions from the solar wind, but even those, not very many. Really, really empty. Whole lot of nothing and little blobs of something, or big blobs of something. Blob, blob, blob. Okay. Let's look at the next image. Full screen. This is now, of course, not to distance scale, or that would be quite a view in the night sky. But this is to size scale, so this gives you an idea of how big the Moon is compared to the Earth. This is actually one of the largest ratios of Moon size to planet size. In fact, the largest if you don't count Pluto as a planet, because Pluto has Charon, which is larger compared to it, but of all the planets, this is the largest Moon to parent body size that we have. Here is your certificate random space fact for the day. You can kind of see it here. Here's Africa. There's the Moon. Certificate random space fact. The surface area of the Moon is about the same as the surface area of Africa. So if you take the whole Moon all around the sphere, it's about the same as the surface area of Africa. So pretty good chunk, but much smaller than the entire surface area of the Earth. All right, that was your certificate random space fact. Let us move on. Let's take some basic, what do you see when you look at the Moon comments. First of all, let's look at the next image full screen. This is the near side of the Moon. So we have, as I mentioned in lecture one, bright areas tend to be higher, called the highlands. Dark areas called mare or maria, that were named after the word sea, but actually are rock. But you have this stuff, which is mostly a rock called an orthosite, and you have here, which is mostly basalt, and we will look at cratering, but basically this area is older, and these areas are younger. When I say younger, they're still mostly 3 to 4 billion years old, but as opposed to 4 billion years old. Let me get out my my toys that I've not warned anyone about. Okay, so note that you always see the same side of the Moon. Technically, you see a little bit of more than one side because the Moon wobbles slightly, but essentially, mostly, you see one side of the Moon. Why is that, and what do we call it? Well, big words for the day: synchronous locked rotation. The Moon is in synchronous locked rotation, or tidally locked, because it's locked by tidal effects. So, if this is the Earth and this is the Moon always faces the same side to the Earth. So as it goes around, it's always facing the same side towards the Earth. This is called, complicatedly enough, the near side. Do not be confused by the term dark side of the Moon. Of course there's a dark side of the Moon, it's the night side, but it changes as the Moon heads around. So if you're where the Sun is, at this point, we're looking, the Earth is, you're lighting up this side of the Moon. If you're over here, you're lighting up this side of the Moon, but the Earth is always seeing the same side, the near side. So it wasn't until we had spacecraft that we could see the far side of the Moon. I'll come back to why it does that, but this is really, really common. That's why it's an important thing to get a hold of now. All of the Moon, big moons in the solar system around planets, other than the ones that are really far out, are tidally locked. It is the stable way things happen in the solar system over long periods of time. And sometimes you can actually get both bodies locked if they're similar in size. So Pluto and Charon, its moon, actually rotate kind of like a dumbbell around each other, like this, always facing each other the same side. Let's look at the next image full screen. We'll come back to fun festive play with spherical objects resembling balls in a moment. This is what we saw. Well, actually, we saw really cruddy pictures from the very first images from the far side of the moon. But once we got really nice spacecraft with nice cameras, good data, this is what the far side of the moon looks like. Notice it looks different. You have lots and lots and lots of highland. Very, very little mare. Very little mare. And it turns out this also is tied to the tidal locking. And so the tidal locking ties to the mass distribution within the secondary body, in this case the moon. And so it likes to line things up. So if you had something that were long and thin, you would tend to line up like Phobos, the moon of Mars, is lined up this way. It's shaped kind of like a potato, and it's always pointing the long end towards Mars. Well, this is basically a similar effect that the stable way when you tug at it and you tug at it and you pull at it with the tides and you get a nice stable configuration, it's going to be dependent upon the mass distribution. Well, the mass distribution in this case is affected by things like mare and where mare can come out and where you have highlands, and so it's not coincidental that the far side of the moon looks really different than the near side of the moon. Okay. You can learn most of the stuff I'm talking about in the textbook, by the way. So don't forget to check that out. On Blackboard, I've put up all the reading assignments. I also have them. If they're not up today, they'll be up the next couple days at planetary.org/betsclass, the reading assignments and book title and all that good stuff. All right, we must move on. Let's talk about some basic things. I do not want you leaving this class without an understanding of lunar phases. So we're going to talk about that, then we'll come back to this whole confusing tidal thing. So next image, full screen. So I'm using the moon to demonstrate various things come up. This is the same reason we see phases of Mercury and Venus. We'll talk about tidal effects that we'll keep coming back to as we look at other planets. So here we got the sunlight coming from this way. The sun's somewhere off there. And these boxes show what the view of the moon looks like from Earth when the moon is in its orbit around the Earth. So easiest to explain is full moon occurs when the moon is on the opposite side of the Earth from the sun. And so the sun is illuminating. We are seeing the entire lit side of the moon, or close to it. When the moon's on the opposite side, we are seeing the night side of the moon, the unlit side of the moon, so that's called new moon. We have various silly terms for other parts. So when you're over here, we're seeing half of the day side and half of the night side. And so because the light side, we're seeing half of the moon that's facing us lit, but it's actually a quarter of the total moon that we're seeing lit up. That's called first quarter. Of course, that gets confusing when this is called full moon, but this is called first quarter when it's over on this side. It's third quarter when it's over on this side. You got the fun word gibbous. This is waxing gibbous as it's getting bigger and bigger, seeing more of the daylight side, waning gibbous, and then we get our crescent moons over on this side, and that's why we get phases, because it's just different amounts of the day side and night side that we're seeing as the moon is orbiting around the Earth. And it revolves around the Earth in a little less than a month. Hence where we get the term month, moon, yada, yada. So that's about the time from one full moon to another full moon, or one new moon to another new moon. All right, let us move on to tides, a little bit more on tides. Let's look at the next image, full screen. So all bodies have gravity. All bodies that have mass have gravity. The more mass you have, the more gravity you have. The closer you are to something, the more gravitational effect for a given mass. The farther away, the less for a given mass. These are exaggerated diagrams showing the ocean on the Earth. So when you pull on something with gravity, water flows, so the oceans are more affected than the land. There actually are solid body tides where the rocks actually flex, but they're not nearly as large as the ocean tides, which are not nearly as large as shown in this diagram. And of course, distance is totally not to scale. but this gives you an idea of what's going on here. So there are two main bodies that tug on the Earth. One is the Sun, because it, as we have discussed, is just seriously massive. The other is the Moon, which although much, much smaller, is much, 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 much closer. And closeness is important to gravity. So we actually get more effect from the Moon than from the Sun, but they're both non-trivial. And so when the Sun and the Moon are both, as the Moon's orbiting around the Earth, and the Moon's lined up roughly with the Sun, then you get this, you get a combined effect of their gravity that's tugging the water that way. So you get high tides off basically this direction. Now, interestingly, you also get a high tide on the opposite side of the planet at the same similar time, because you don't have as much gravity tugging on the water on this side, so it's able to flow this way. And so you get tides off that way. This is called spring tide with the new moon. And similarly, when you put the moon on the opposite side, you got the moon tugging on the water over here, you got the sun tugging on the water over here. So you get your maximum tides here and here when the moon's on the far side and the near side, or the sun side and the anti-sun side. Those are called spring tides, those are the biggest tides. Now, when you got the moon over on the side, the moon's tugging this way, the sun's tugging this way. The moon dominates because gravity, and this is something you need to know if you're in the course, gravity falls off as 1 over r squared, where r is the distance between two bodies. Suffice it to say, this means for, I'll come back to this, but for our purposes here, distance is really important. And so distance to the moon, you actually get more gravity, you get dominant tides over on this side, you still get some tides here that, and you don't get them adding together, so neap tides are not as extreme as spring tides. But wait, don't worry yet. This has been a highly oversimplified version of how tides work. The next piece, and we aren't going to get to all the complicated pieces, but the next piece is the Earth is rotating. And the Earth is rotating faster than the Moon is revolving. Vocabulary point! Rotation is what an object does, like a planet, as it goes around its axis. Revolution, revolving, is what one body does when it's going around another body. So rotation, revolution. So as the moon is revolving, taking a little less than a month to go around the Earth's rotating once every day. And so as it does so, and the moon's tugging on a tidal bulge of water over here, and the moon's moving like this, but the sun, I can't even possibly do this with my hands, but you get the idea, hopefully, moon's moving slower than the Earth is rotating. So that rotates the bulge being pulled by the moon out front, because it's rotating like that. Why do I mention this? Well, one, it's to understand tides. Two, it has an interesting effect. The moon is still trying to pull back on that bulge, and the Earth, that bulge, is trying to pull on the moon. The combined effect is that the moon is slowing the rotation of the Earth. So right now, the Earth rotates in 24 hours, about. If you go back a long time, not on Earth, not on human time scales, really, but if you go back hundreds of millions, billions of years, you don't have a 24-hour day, you've got a 20-hour day, or a 15-hour day, or a 10-hour day. The Earth had much shorter days in its distant past. And similarly, the moon, the similar effect is what happens is the Earth is slowing down its rotation, and the moon is getting farther away. And so the moon used to be in closer, and the Earth used to be rotating faster. Now this is happening. Very slowly. Again, not really on Earth human timescales. Although, we actually been able to measure the moon moving away at on the order of a centimeter a year. Can't remember the exact number, but that's ballpark. By using retroreflectors left by astronauts on the moon, you shoot a laser to the retroreflector, measure the time coming back. Well, over the decades, we indeed have confirmed this effect. Moon's getting farther away. All right, various oddball things to know about the moon, to know about basics, about tides and phases and dribbling balls. Let us now talk about moon as a history object. So why would we care about the moon as a history object? Let us take a look at the next random space fact video. And this one really does have someone you probably will recognize in it with me. And this will set the stage. So go ahead and run that with its sound up whenever you're ready.
Hey, here's a cool fact. Most of the youngest moon rocks are older than most of the oldest Earth rocks. Most moon rocks are between 3 and 4 billion years old.
That's old. Join us next week for another episode of Grandpa Space Pants.
Dr. Betts.
Yes?
Bruce, it's not Grandpa Space Pants. It's random space fact. Is this some dig against me because I'm old, because I have a lot of gray hair?
Is no, that what this is no, about? Definitely not. No.
Well, then how do you explain this?
Once again, proving that science is serious. It's serious stuff. So, the actual fact to pull out of that, as opposed to the hopefully amusing parts, is the moon rocks tend to be much older than Earth rocks. Let's take a look at the next graph, and we'll look at that in a little bit more detail. So let's look at this full screen. This is a histogram of the ages of Earth rocks up here and moon rocks down here. This is how age with the present here and 4 billion years ago. Planet formation occurred 4.5 billion years ago over here. Notice Earth rocks are down on this part of the scale, and notice moon rocks are on this part of the scale. And notice if you bring them together, you can kind of get a history across the ages of our solar system. Why is this? Well, the Earth rocks are constantly getting replaced or changed or eroded. There are new volcanic features, there's plate tectonics, there's water erosion. You don't have any of these on the moon. You had volcanism, and that's what formed the mare to lead ahead, but you don't have this constant resurfacing that you've got on Earth. So the moon preserves a record of the early solar system. That's pretty cool if you want to understand what was going on in the early solar system, and you've lost that record, by and large, on the surface of the Earth. So, yeah. Now let's take a look at some closer images of the highlands and the mare. So let's look at the next image. This is from the highlands. Look at all the impact craters. This is what a surface looks like when you leave it out in our solar system for 4 billion years or more, is you just get crater upon crater upon crater upon crater upon crater, etc. And in fact, this surface looks like it's pretty close to it. Some of it is saturated, meaning that for every new crater you put there, you basically erase one crater. So you reach a maximum density at some point, and this is close to it. And the highlands look like this. The highlands are really left over from pretty early in the process, 4 billion-ish years ago. Now, it's not like the Mare are young. Let's look at the next image. I'm sorry, this is still highlands, so this is a slightly less cratered, but again, I remind you of, we talked about superposition, so you can tell this crater was younger than this crater. It's a pretty basic concept, but we'll keep coming back to it, and you can use it to understand and read the history of the surface you're looking at. Notice the variety of craters all over the place. You got smaller ones tend to be bowl-shaped. Larger ones like this that are in the maybe 10 kilometer size generate central peaks that are a rebound after the impact. The rock rebounds back up in the center. You get the larger craters. You've got craters that are eroding other craters through additional impact. So again, just a first cursory look, the moon tells us cratering was impact was really important early in the solar system. Let's look at the next image, and this is the Mare. Look how many fewer craters we have. We still have big tens of kilometer type craters. You can see the ejecta is the material thrown out. But you can also see that there that you've got areas with very few craters at this scale. You can probably see, or certainly in other images, see that lava has flooded in and surrounded the other craters, or surrounded uplifted mountain areas. You have other more exotic volcanic type features going on in addition to cratering. So the Mari are still really old. It's not like on human time frames they happened yesterday. They're still 3 billion years old, 3 to 4 billion. But they're at a period, they go back to a period where they missed the heaviest bombardment. So you have the heaviest bombardment. Here's kind of what happened with the history is that the heaviest bombardment dug out these big giant impact basins, hundreds of kilometers, hundreds of miles across. And then over time, as you still had a molten mantle, a molten inside of the moon, you had lava come out. You had lava flows, and that's what filled in those big, deep craters and basins, giant areas, and that's what formed the Mare, the dark regions. They are basalt as opposed to the other stuff. What's interesting is the highlands, the basic initial formation was probably from a magma ocean. So essentially after you formed the moon, everything was molten, and the light stuff floated to the top, heavy stuff floated to the bottom, and what crystallized is what formed the highlands. Then you pounded on that for a while, you had some volcanism, you formed the Mare, blah, 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 moon. All right, let's take a look at the next image. I'll come back to moon formation in just a moment. First, there are tons of images that are just glorious of the moon. There have been, in exploration history of the moon, we've gone there, not surprisingly, more than any other place in the solar system besides Earth. We're right around 100 spacecraft that have gone to the moon, either flyby, orbiters, landers, rovers that have gone to the moon. Lots of pictures. I'm just going to show you a small sampling. Let's look at this image full screen. This is one of the younger large craters on the moon. Can actually be seen fairly easily from Earth with binoculars or a telescope. It's called Copernicus. This is a view looking kind of edge on from a spacecraft going around, and you can see the large crater. You can see some slumping of the walls. You can see a central peak. Craters going on. You can see some of the ejecta blanket, the material that was thrown out, causing this rough material around here. All right. Let us take a look at some more images through this video. This video is from a colleague I used to work with, who's now at Goddard Space Flight Center, Jim Garvin, and he's got his five top images from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter camera. So Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter is a NASA spacecraft, went into orbit I think in 2009, still collecting great data about the moon, orbiting right now, has taken stunning images, has a lot of other great instruments. Let's take a look at this video, and then we'll come back and finish off the moon.
Flies us to the moon, revealing images captured by LROC, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter camera. Since 2009, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter spacecraft has been mapping the moon. Here are my top five favorite images. Number five, Aristarchus. What you're seeing here is Mother Nature's expression of a gigantic landform made by a cosmic collision, an impact crater. 14,000 feet of relief is shown in this picture. The inner wall slopes of this giant impact crater expressing rocks that have been excavated from beneath the lunar crust, shown for the first time here by Mother Nature. This is how the solar system works. Moving on to number four, the lunar south pole. In this image, you see what may be the coldest place in the solar system. In the shadows of the craters you see here, the temperatures may be below 25 degrees Kelvin, colder than Pluto. In this image, we also see places where there may be lurking the relics of ancient ices frozen in this part of the solar system billions of years ago. Number three, moon ejecta. In this image, almost reminiscent of abstract art, we see the process of impact cratering on the surface of the moon in its most pristine state. We see how the dust and rocks that are displaced or excavated by this process are distributed on the lunar surface. This beautiful image shows us how that process works throughout the solar system. On to number two, lunar pit craters. In this very revealing image, we see what is in effect a hole, showing a shadow revealing the underside of the lunar crust, by a process that we think is associated with collapse. Perhaps collapse over an ancient river of lava that flowed on the moon long ago, revealing for us subterranean tunnels. This spectacular image really suggests for us new environments on the moon, those not at the surface, very worthy of future exploration. And the top spot goes to the Tycho impact crater, formed by a colossal cosmic collision on the moon around the time the dinosaurs roamed here on Earth. And as we zoom in on the picture, we can see the consequences of that giant impact process, producing for us 15,000 foot mountains reminiscent of the biggest on Earth, at the top of which are giant rocks, big blocks the size of buildings, displaced by Mother Nature instantly. This is Mother Nature at her best. So those are my top picks from LROC. I'm Jim Garvin, signing off.
Pretty cool. So there is still groovy lunar stuff going on, still new insights we're getting into the moon, which, as planets and moons go, in some ways has a simpler history, but like everything, another theme of the course, the more we study it, the more we find surprises that it's actually more complicated than we thought. All right, let's look at the next image full screen. This was one of Jim Garvin's images. This is the central peak from the Tycho crater with this enormous mountain. Notice the shadows. I point this out to indicate things look very different in planetary images depending on what time of day you look at. So this is from either the early morning or late afternoon, where you get this massive shadow makes the height of this very obvious. If you were looking right at noontime, there would be no shadows. It would be much harder to really sense that as much. Opposite extreme almost of size, the moon has impact basins hundreds of kilometers in size, Tycho tens of kilometers. Let's look at the next image. This is actually from a bit of glass on the scale of microns, millionths of a meter. So think, you know, width of a human hair, smaller. Scanning electron microscope of glass, and this is glass in a geologist's sense, not just like window glass, but any rock that freezes out very quickly and so doesn't have a crystalline structure. It's amorphous. That part's not important. What is important is this. Even this tiny, tiny bit of glass brought back by the astronauts from the moon has an impact crater in it. So you've got impact craters all the way from the scale that you have to use electron microscopes to the scale that we see evidence of hundreds of kilometer basins on the surface of the moon. Why do we get such tiny impacts on the moon? Well, remember we talked about meteors last week and 100 tons of stuff hitting the Earth's atmosphere every day. Well, that burns up in the Earth's atmosphere, but the moon has essentially no atmosphere. So even the tiniest dust hits. How does it put a hole in a rock? Well, when the dust is going several kilometers per second, that makes a hole. Now to the really opposite scale, let's talk about origin of the moon. Next image, full screen. This is a painting by Bill Hartman, who's a planetary scientist and also an astronomical artist. And this depicts what we think was the origin event of the moon. So this is a proto-Earth, meaning it's kind of almost as big as the Earth, but it's not the Earth yet. Different material has been accreting, sticking together, making larger and larger bodies, early history of the solar system. Then this big, ginormous, almost Mars-sized object comes along, strikes at an angle up at on one edge of the Earth, throws out material. Let's look at the next image. And it's hard to see, but this is astronomical art based on things like this next image, which is computer simulations of the Earth moon. When you're ready, put up the next image. In the meantime, I'll talk about it. There we go. So this is showing an impactor up here slamming into an Earth, and then that throws out material. And that material is going around the Earth. Most of that material falls back to the Earth, does not escape the Earth. But a small blorb, which, you know, isn't that small, makes it successfully into orbit around the Earth, and that material slams into each other, eventually sticks together, forms the moon. Now you may think, well, that is just bizarro. How can you possibly believe something as crazy as that? Well, because the evidence actually matches it. Strangely enough, so there were other theories like the Earth moon formed together at the same time, or even that the Earth was spun up and then some material came off of it and formed the moon. Turns out this, by far, the impact hypothesis fits the data the best, by far. And why is a couple of ways it does is the moon is much less dense than the Earth. And so if you had an early Earth, a proto-Earth, that was early on, lots of impact, lots of heat from the formation, you end up having the heavy stuff going to the center. That's why we have an iron core in the Earth. You leave more light material towards the outside. This comes along, strips off material only from the outside. You end up with an object that's much less dense than the Earth, which the moon is. You also end up with material that, in terms of the elements, in terms of how they play with each other, the composition of the moon, the rocks that have been analyzed that came back, it all kind of fits. And, you know, nothing's perfect. They're still working and tweaking the details. But fundamentally, this is what by far the most accepted theory of moon formation is. Then as the moon formed and as the moon differentiated, that's that process, the heaviest stuff going to the center, well, that releases more energy. And you end up melting the whole outside of the moon. You get this magma ocean that then solidifies, crystallizes, and you form what becomes the highlands. You then keep hitting it with ginormous impactors and little impactors. You then flood the basins with lava. Bingo, bango, bongo, you end up with the moon. In a nutshell. At least all the nutshell we have time for. Next image, I just want to give you the quick summary of how we usually explore other planets and moons. Again, the moon, 100 objects have been sent there by humans, roughly. Let's look at this full screen. This is kind of the standard way, almost always, but not always followed when we explore with spacecraft. You usually have flybys at first because it takes less energy, less complicated orbits, and then you end up going back with orbiters that go into orbit. It takes fancier rockets, better orbital planning, and then if it's a giant planet like Jupiter, you put in atmospheric probes, or surface like Mars, you put down landers. Then if you hope you get to rovers and more mobility. And this is where we are with Mars, for example. You also then ideally do sample return. And we've done some small sample return from cometary comas with Stardust, solar wind with Genesis, a little bit of asteroid material with Hayabusa, and then of course lots of sample return from the moon, both robotic, that the Soviets did, and then humans. And remember this, humans have only gone to one other place in the solar system, one other body, and that is the moon. 12 humans landed on the surface of the moon over the course of 6 missions that successfully went to the surface of the moon. And that, of course, was the Apollo program, so that really distinguishes the moon from everywhere else. And they did science while they were there and collected materials. Let's look at the next image and talk a little bit about Apollo. Let's look at this full screen. This is Apollo 11, first lander, first human landing on the moon. This, I believe, is Buzz Aldrin with Neil Armstrong taking the picture. And notice what the lunar lander looked like, the lunar module. This is not some sleek rocket-looking design because it only has to work in the vacuum of space. There's no atmosphere that you have to deal with, so you can make it as weird shaped as you want. You don't have to worry about putting wings or having fancy curves and curvature to match aerodynamics. I want to make sure also that all of you, you've probably all seen this, but in case you haven't, let's look at 10 seconds of video of Neil Armstrong speaking the first words from a human stepping onto the surface of the moon. And I believe you'll see a couple different versions of the video. It's a restored video comparing to the old video, but you get the idea. Let's go ahead and run that.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
All right, at least I did not hear the audio, so I will do an incredible representation. That's one small step for man and one giant leap for mankind. Except he didn't talk in that weird voice. One giant leap for mankind. Of course, famous moment, humans stepping foot onto another world. All the Apollo missions were between 16, all the lunar landing Apollo missions were between 69 and 72. Now, let's take a look at some Apollo, a couple quick Apollo images. So as they chose landing sites, they went to more and more complicated sites. They also had two humans going down to the surface while one was orbiting, and they were taking pictures along the way. There also were a whole bunch of precursor spacecraft, lunar orbiters, the rangers, the surveyors, all sorts of stuff. Let's look at this image full screen. This happens to be an image from Apollo 12. Big crater, nice superposition, crater on top of a crater. Open areas, there are ridges from faulting going on. Notice, as always, no blue sky, no clouds, no atmosphere. Next image. This is this is where Apollo 15 landed, and it has this amazing thing called Hadley Rill, which is a collapsed lava tube, or lava channel, I should say. And also, you can see there's always craters, no matter where you go, because there are always old surfaces. They got more adventurous with later landing sites. So first, they just wanted to get down safely. They landed in Mare. Eventually, they started going to Highland-Mare regions, more exotic places. Next image. So this is from Apollo 15. Notice, I guess that doesn't look too great, but black sky. I believe this is the Earth in the background. They were going where they were now near mountains. They brought along Apollo 15, a car. That's right, monster truck racing, dune buggy on the lunar surface. And so that made a big difference. Let's look at the next video clip, a short video clip with my sound up of, this happens to be the Apollo 17 rover. And you can see what they did. So go ahead and run that when you're ready. So the rovers allowed them to obviously cover a lot more ground as they were collecting samples, doing science. Notice the dust coming off of there for two reasons. One, notice it's hard to tell, but it stays up longer. The gravity's lower on the moon. Do not be confused by cartoons that pretend the moon has no gravity. The gravity on the surface of the moon is 16% of the Earth's gravity. So when you kick up dust, it takes longer to fall, or dirt. Dust is more complicated because the Earth has an atmosphere that may keep it up there. But if you throw a rock, it's going to fall a wee bit slower. But there is gravity. Do not be confused. Also, notice that dust flying around. You need fenders to protect yourself from that dust. Actually, let's look at... Sorry, I'm getting confused. Let's look at one more image. Sorry. One more image, and then we'll run a video. No, I'm wrong. Let's look at a few more images, four more images, and we'll start going quickly through these. So let's look at this full, there we go, full screen. So this is Apollo 15 landing site, and again, this is Hadley Rill in here. Notice now they're getting courageous landing on this boundary region with the mountains, examining the rill. This is just a traverses, shows where they walked. Next image. This is Apollo 16. Now they actually went into the highlands, a heavier cratered region, and this shows traverses of where they traveled, both with rovers and walking. Next image. This is Apollo 16 from the orbiter, showing this very heavily cratered terrain. Next image. So here is Apollo 16 with the rover, and notice the fender, which is the point of another random space fact video, and there's the lander back there. Let's go ahead and run the next random space fact video, and then we'll come back and finish off.
After accidentally breaking a fender on the Apollo 17 lunar rover while it was on the moon, the astronauts fabricated a makeshift fender using just sturdy maps, clamps, and, of course, duct tape. Now, I'm no Apollo astronaut, but I'm gonna take a shot at this to show you how it was done. Yes, it's amazing how a few simple items and a lot of ingenuity can efficiently solve problems, even on the moon. Okay, put this clamp here. The actual makeshift fender is now on display at the National Air and Space Museum. Just a little more tape, and... dang it!
So, Dr. Betts.
Yes.
This is the fender on the rover.
Yep, just fixing it.
I'm sure this is a compelling pedagogical moment.
Oh, yes.
But we do have a meeting. Just 5 minutes.
Okay.
You...
I'm fine.
Let's go ahead and look at, that actually happened. They've got the fender in the replacement fender that they brought back with duct tape and maps in the Smithsonian Museum. Let's skip the next video, but look at the next roughly four pictures, and then we'll talk about eclipses next time around. Let's look at the next image, full screen. So this is from Lunar LROC, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter camera. And now they can get such amazing resolution from orbit, you can actually see the lander, the bottom part of the lander. So when the astronauts left the moon, they would launch with the top part of the lander and leave the bottom part of the lander on the moon. You can actually see that, and you can actually see these little paths. Those are walking paths where the astronauts walked, and you can see these rover tracks where you have two sets of tracks next to each other. Pretty amazing, and again, because there's no erosion, there's no atmosphere, there's just slow impact erosion, all those things are still visible all these decades later, even from orbit if you have a big enough camera. Next image. This is Apollo 12, and again shows descent stage, also shows part of Surveyor. They actually landed Apollo 12 next to one of the robotic landers and took pieces off of it and brought it back to Earth to understand the environment of what happened when it was sitting out on the moon. This is 200 meters for a scale bar. Next image is just show you a really different kind of data. These are temperatures measured by Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, and this is obviously false color. This is in the South Polar region, and the point here is these dark areas are coded to really cold temperatures, only tens of degrees above absolute zero. These are some of the coldest places in the entire solar system, oddly enough, occur on the moon because they're permanently shadowed craters. And we'll see some of those on Mercury also, areas that don't receive sunlight and haven't for billions of years. And so if water ice comes like from comets and then eventually migrates into those cold traps, water ice is incredibly stable at those very cold temperatures, and we've confirmed it is there, maybe mixed with rock and dust, but there is water ice in those polar, really, really cold craters. Really cold because of the no atmosphere. All right, come back next time. We'll talk about eclipses. We'll talk about Mercury. We'll compare the triad planets, Venus, Mars, Earth. It'll be great. Thank you. Good night.